good morning. It's good to see everybody this morning at Hardison Baptist Church. Let's get a songbook and let's stand as we sing page 46. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prosper fall. Bring forth the royal diamond and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diamond and crown him Lord of all. Ye chosen seed of Israel's race, he ransomed from the fall. Saves you by his grace and crown him Lord of all. Hail him who saves you by his grace and crown him Lord of all. Let every kindred, every tribe on this celestial ball to ascribe and crown him Lord of all. To him all majesty ascribe and crown him Lord of all. Oh, that with yonder sacred throne we at his feet may fall. We'll join the and crown him Lord of all.
Amen. It's good to see you here with us this morning at Hardison Baptist Church. So let's open our service with a word of prayer. Brother Bob, would you lead us, please, sir? Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Just a few quick announcements this morning. The bulletin, I trust you've been watching the announcements on the screen and then grab a bulletin. There's lots of things coming up in the next month or so. No ladies' Bible study this Tuesday, so ladies, make sure you mark that on your calendar and make that change in your week. And then the rest of our weekly stuff is kind of the same Wednesday night Bible study here in the auditorium for the adults, and the kids are back in the back. And then several things coming up next Saturday is a wedding here at Hardison Baptist Church for William Anthony and Laura Davenport. So looking forward to that, 3:00, and they have invited the whole church. So you are welcome to be here and celebrate with them this coming Saturday at 3:00. Here at Hardison Baptist Church. Other things coming up, monthly men's meeting at 9 a.m. on September 28th, the following Saturday, so we're just looking forward to those things. And you can kind of look down through these things and make sure you're marking your calendar and making plans for that. We did add one thing, the potluck dinner after the morning service on October 6th, so that's our redo from Labor Day weekend, so I hope you'll put that on your calendar and make plans to be here with us. But just make these marks in your calendar and keep up with these things. And continue to pray for our church. Continue to pray for our pulpit committee. Continue to pray for God's will as we search for the next pastor of our church and as we just continue to serve him while we're searching. So we're very thankful for every one of you. And I just ask that you continue to pray for the church. And hoping to have a good meeting this morning. Thank you all for being here. Brother Charles, come lead us in another song.
So we continue singing this morning. Let's turn to page 79. To God be the glory. just great things He hath done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But purer and higher will be our wonder, our transport when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, we'll come to the Father through Jesus the Son and give Him the glory, great things He hath done. All right, let's turn to page 627. Let's stand as we sing, What a Day That Will Be. There is coming a day when no heartaches shall come, no more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eye. What a day, glorious day that will be. There'll be no sorrow there, no more burdens to bear, no more sickness, no pain, no more parting over there. And forever I will be with the one who died for me. What a day. Upon His face, the one who saved me by His grace, when He takes me by the hand and leads me through that promised land. What a day, glorious day that will be.
Almost fell. Oh, there we go.
I come to the garden alone. I'll let you. It's still on the roses, and the voice I hear calling on my ear, the Son of God discloses, and He walks with me, and He talks with me, and He tells their singing, and the melody that He gave to me within my heart is ringing.
walks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. I stay in the garden with him, though the night around me be falling, but he bids me go to the voice of woe. His voice to me is calling, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever.
Part of our services, so it is a time that we can worship him with our voices. And you may say, well, I don't sing very well. There's nowhere in the Bible that it says you need to sing well to worship in song. So sing as unto the Lord, and he will be honored and glorified. So this morning, let me just start by saying, here goes Brandy going, oh no, he's going to be too transparent. You know, two weeks ago, I think it was, I preached on the oppression of demons and how they can, if we know Christ as our Savior, they cannot possess us, but I believe they can oppress us. And this morning, it just seems like they're working hard. I don't know why. I don't know what's going on. I don't know what's going on in your life and your heart, but this morning it just seems like they're in overtime. I don't know about you, but they are working on me. And I don't like it. I'm about to preach God's word, and that's more powerful than any demon or any oppression or anything else in this world. And I'm not saying that to puff me out. I'm saying that because this word is so powerful. And Satan does not want it to go out. He doesn't want you to hear it. He doesn't want you to listen to it. He doesn't want you to put it into practice. So I don't know what we're struggling with this morning as far as just individually, but I want to commit this time to him specifically so that our hearts and our minds can be on what God has for us from his word, and we can get what the Holy Spirit wants us to get. Father, I lift up to you this time. I don't know why it feels like there's such an oppression, such a going after the word of God and of my mind this morning. But Lord, I know that greater is he who's in me than he who's in the world. And I'm going to claim that promise this morning. And Lord, I pray that as the word of God goes forth, that your name will be glorified. Lord, that you would hold these demons at bay. Keep the devil away from our hearts and minds as we listen to your word this morning. Draw us closer to you because of what we hear. Clear our minds, clear our hearts, and allow us to hear from your word. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Mark chapter 5. Lord willing, we will finish Mark this morning. This will be our fourth morning in the book of Mark chapter 5. Last week, we kind of started this story, but it got interrupted. And if you aren't here, or if you're watching via live stream, you're like, oh man, what interrupted? Did somebody jump up? Somebody bring a chicken in the service again? Y'all are like, again? Yeah, tell me, ask me later, I'll tell you about it. But no, the story got interrupted as Jesus was going with Jairus. A woman with an issue of blood interrupted his journey. And I'm so thankful, and we looked at that last week, so thankful that Jesus allowed that interruption. He didn't say, I'm sorry, ma'am, I'm sorry, I'm too busy. Do you see all these people around me? I'm too busy. I'm too popular. I can't stop and talk to you right now. This man's a ruler of the synagogue. I'm going to his house. No, he didn't. He said, who touched me? I love that story. We talked about it last week. I won't be reteaching it this morning, but it is part of this story. We'll skip the part in the Bible about that we looked at last week about the woman with the issue of blood, but it will tie together. Back to Mark chapter 5, we started reading at verse 21 last week because it's part of the interruption that we looked at last week. But this week we'll look at the story that's at the beginning and the end of that interruption. Mark chapter 5, verse 21, the Bible says, and when Jesus had passed over again by ship unto the other side, much people gathered unto him, and he was nigh unto the sea. And behold, there cometh one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name, and when he saw him, he fell at his feet, and besought him greatly, saying, my little daughter lieth at the point of death, I pray thee, come and lay hands on her that she may be healed, and she shall live. The first part of verse 24 says, and Jesus went with him. Jairus, here it says he's a ruler of the synagogue. One commentary said that he's like a pastor in the fact that he oversees the spiritual and the financial or business affairs of the synagogue. But for him to come to Jesus was a big thing. I imagine that he had already exhausted all of his resources among the Jewish religious crowd because he is one of them. But maybe Jesus' reputation preceded Jesus, and maybe Jairus had heard of him, no doubt he had, and he had done some homework, possibly. And when his daughter was sick to the point of death, and when the Bible doesn't tell us anything about her disease or her, her sickness, so we don't know if it was prolonged or if it came on all of a sudden. But either way, Jairus is here. When Jesus steps off the boat, it says a great crowd was there to greet him, to see him, and Jairus sees Jesus, and however he gets an audience with him, he gets an audience with him. And he goes up to him, and he says, my daughter, my little daughter, lieth at the point of death. He inquired of Jesus to have him come heal his daughter. We seem to put a tag on all of the religious leaders of that day, that none of them believed in Jesus. But this shows us that that's not true. But also in John chapter 9, if you're familiar with that story, which I'm sure you are, I'm sure you read it this week in your devotions, the John chapter 9 is the story where Jesus heals a blind man, a man who was blind from his birth. And the whole chapter is about that man and that story, the whole chapter. And as Jesus, he heals this man, and after he heals him, people are disputing whether or not this is actually that blind man. But it is. And he says, I am he that was blind. Well, this was done on, can you guess what day? The Sabbath. It was done on the Sabbath day. Jesus could have made a lot of things a lot less complicated if he hadn't done things on the Sabbath day. But you know what? He knows best. And I'm so glad he did, because he was trying to show that man's rules, now you say, but the Bible says, keep the Sabbath for it's holy. Yes. But remember a few weeks ago we talked about traditions of elders, traditions of men, how many rules they put in place about the Sabbath. that were a little on the ridiculous side, because they felt like maybe the Mosaic Law was a little vague, so they had to put in some extra stuff to help everybody understand what it means to keep the Sabbath. And it meant that they weren't supposed to take but so many steps, they weren't supposed to do any work, those type things. And Jesus chooses to heal people on the Sabbath because he's not limited by a day. But in this chapter, John chapter 9, in verse 16, it says this: "Therefore said some of the Pharisees, this man is not of God, because he keepeth not the Sabbath day. Others said, how can a man that is a sinner do such miracles? And there was a division among them." Can you imagine that division? The religious leaders, some holding true to their traditions and to what they believed the Mosaic Law taught, and some seeing Jesus, who is the Messiah, and going, there's something different about him. I can't put my finger on it, but there's just something different. And Jairus apparently was one of those who said, this guy's the real thing. And I don't know how to transition over. I'm sure it was a difficult thing on his heart and mind, because here he is, the ruler of the synagogue, and he's beginning to believe in Jesus. But then his faith is put to the test. Something that I would imagine, if we had the time, we could go around the room and every one of us could give a testimony of a time our faith was put to the test. And maybe some of us would say, my faith was put to the test, but I didn't do so well. And maybe you can say, man, glory to God, I was put to the test, my faith was, and the Lord was honored. Jairus is at a point where he has to put wheels or feet to his faith. And it says that, and as verse 21, "And when Jesus passed over again by ship unto the other side, much people gathered unto him, and he was nigh unto the sea. And behold, there cometh one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name. And when he saw him, he fell at his feet." A ruler of the synagogue amongst a large crowd. You know, there were a couple other rulers that came to Jesus, didn't they? Jesus of Arimathea, Nicodemus. How did they come to Jesus? By night, in secret. Because they said, until I get this figured out, I can't be seen talking to Jesus. I can't let my brothers know. I can't let the public know that I'm going to talk to this man who they can't stand. But Jairus says, no, my daughter is more important than my reputation in this community. I don't care what people think. I got to talk to Jesus. And he believed that Jesus could heal his daughter. And he came to him in verse 23 and besought him greatly, earnestly, saying, my little girl lieth at the point of death. I pray thee, please come and lay hands on her that she may be healed and she shall live. You know, Jairus has faith, doesn't he? But do you think he has enough faith? And you're like, what do you mean? Does he have enough faith? We know that over in Luke chapter 7, there was a centurion that had a servant that was near to him, dear to him, that was sick. Do you remember what that centurion told Jesus? He said, would you please heal my servant? And Jesus said, sure. And he said, but you can't come to my house. I'm a ruler like you are. Jesus, if you'll just speak the words, I know he'll be healed. Wow. And then the Bible says that Jesus marveled. He had never seen such faith, no, not in Israel. That's some faith. Lord, if you'll just speak the words, I know my servant will be healed. And was he? Yes, he was. At the very same moment that he spoke that he would be healed. So does Jairus have enough faith? Well, if you compare it to the centurion, oh no, he lacks faith because he says, Jesus, I need you to come lay hands on her. I need you to come. I need you physically at my house with my daughter to heal her. Well, what if one of the disciples said back there, well, he ain't got enough faith. He could have just did like that centurion said and just said, Lord, just speak it and it'll happen. And I'll go home and she'll be playing. He ain't got enough faith. You ever feel like you don't have enough faith? Like you just feel like God's not going to answer my prayers because, oh ye of little faith, I don't have enough faith. When we were in Pensacola, I was still in college. We had just gotten married, and at Pensacola Christian College, your senior year as a ministerial student, you get the opportunity to go work in a local church. Man, I tell you, that was great. I loved my college days. Now, when I was in them, I wouldn't have said that so emphatically. But I loved my college days and the fact that what I learned, the things I was exposed to, the teachers I was able to rub shoulders with, and they cared about me just like you would want them to. But being able to go work in a local church was so key. And the school knew that. That's why they had this program. And because I had two senior years, I got to work there, be there for 2 years. So our beginning, when we got married, we moved from here to Pensacola, and within about 2 months, we changed our membership to Cantonment Baptist Church in Cantonment, Florida, just about 15 minutes north of Pensacola. Little church, probably physically half the size of this auditorium, maybe a third, and that was it. Had one little, it was like a storage building out to the side, and then a little fellowship hall type thing, little bitty wing, but the storage building was like the teen room, you know, and where it was about 40 people. Hey guys, we have wooden pews at Cantonment. Yeah, you better be thankful for them padded pews you're sitting on, because y'all shift sometimes and go, man, I'm uncomfortable. Well, sit there for an hour and a half with somebody long-winded on a wooden pew, and you'll be like, man, I look forward. I was like, man, I've missed my pews at Hardison. But seriously, our pastor was Ray Davis. He had felt, he was in his 50s, felt led of the Lord to be called into missions. He left the pastorate, raised his support, and they went to Ghana, West Africa. So now here I am, Randy and I are at this church, and we're like, ah, now we're without a pastor. And so things keep going. Everything's fine. But it's that emptiness of not having that person that you came there under, and just kind of like, well, what do we do now? Well, the church found a way, and we got an interim pastor, and his name was Dr. Robert Kendall. Dr. Kendall passed away in 2020. I looked him up a couple months ago, and I hated to see that his obituary popped up. But he was a very learned man. Matter of fact, if you have a Strong's Concordance at home that was printed after about 2001, flip to the front where it gives credit to people, and you'll see Dr. Robert Kendall's name. Very smart man, very well-educated, very learned, but he could break it down so that you and I could understand Greek and Hebrew. Well, Dr. Kendall had a health issue ongoing with his kidneys. And Dr. Kendall spent quite a bit of time in the hospital. He told us of one of the times he was in the hospital that a colleague of his came to visit him in the hospital. And as Dr. Kendall laid there receiving treatment for his kidney issue at the time, this high horse rider came in and said, Robert, if you had enough faith, you could just get up and walk out of here, because if you had enough faith, you'd be healed. And Dr. Kendall was crushed. No, he wasn't. He just sat there for a moment. And I don't remember, he didn't, if he told us the guy's name, I don't remember. Well, let's call him Frank. He said, "Frank, let me have your glasses." And Frank said, kind of bowed up a little, and he said, "Well, what do you want with my glasses? If I give you my glasses, I can't see." He said, "Frank, if you had enough faith, you wouldn't need them." It's not how much faith we have, but the object of our faith. Jairus had faith. He came to Jesus. He exercised his faith. In daytime, he came to Jesus and he fell at his feet. Almost a form of worship, and beckoned Jesus to come heal his daughter. And Jesus, nothing's recorded. This is also in Luke 8 and Matthew 8, and nothing's recorded that Jesus says anything to Jairus, but he just follows him. Well, remember, there's a great crowd around him, and as they go, last week's story falls into place. There's a great crowd, I'm just going to sum it up. There's a great crowd following, just thronging him, Mark chapter 5 says. And as they're going, they're just pushing all against him because these people can't wait to see what Jesus is going to do next. They just heard Jairus' request that his daughter is sick, and they're like, "Man, he's fixing to go heal somebody. I want to see this." And as they're going, this woman with an issue of blood for 12 years. Remember I asked you last week, what were you doing in 2012? And you were like, "Yeah, I think I can remember." 12 years she had this disease. 12 years of a bleeding problem. 12 years of the Levitical law hanging over her head, and she cannot be clean. She's unclean. She can't touch anybody. If she fixes food for someone, the food is unclean. She can't sit in a chair and someone else sit in that chair because now the chair is unclean. The bed that she lays in is unclean. Her whole life is separation because she's unclean. Because of this disease, which, by the way, she didn't ask for it. Maybe she didn't even deserve it. But she's got it. And she comes in and she says to herself, "That's Jesus. And if I can just touch the hem of his garment, I'll be whole. I'll be healed." The Bible says she spent all she had on doctors and was nothing bettered, but actually grew worse. She's at the point of giving up. But she says, "If I can just touch his garment, I'll be healed." And she takes a bold move. She pushes in through the crowd because it says they're thronging him. They're all around him. Knowing that everybody she bumps into, she's making them unclean. But she says, "I have to touch him. I have to be healed. I have no other hope." And she pushes in through the crowd, apparently on the ground at some point, and she touches the hem of his garment, just barely touches his garment. And Jesus stops because the Bible says that she knew at that point the issue of blood was dried up. She knew she had been healed. And Jesus stopped. And you remember what we saw Jesus ask? "Hey, who touched me?" And if you look over in Luke, it says it was Peter. Y'all knew it was Peter. He says, "Lord, do you see this crowd? What do you mean, who touched you? They were all around you. We're trying to keep them off of you, but it's kind of hard to because they're all like pushing in and stuff." He says, No. "Virtue went out of me. Who touched me?" And the Bible says that she came fear with fear and trembling and fell at his feet and told her the whole story. And last week I pointed out, did this take 5 minutes or did this take 45 minutes? I don't know. But there's a man over here who's not very happy about this interruption. He says, what's going on? What's he doing back there? Who's he talking to? What's he doing? Why isn't he following me? Where did the crowd go? What happened? And he looks back and sees Jesus talking to this lady. And he probably feels somewhat forgotten. Like, I thought he was going with me. My daughter's at the point of death, and he's stopping to socialize. Jesus, why don't you, hello, hey, my daughter. Jesus is focused on his daughter. Did you see that? I didn't point that out last week. I didn't really notice it as far as it didn't come to. Look at verse, where are we at? Look at verse 34. And he said unto her, daughter, thy faith hath made thee whole. Go in peace and be whole of thy plague. Ladies, have you ever been called daughter by someone who's not your dad or by your dad? It's a term of endearment. It means you're mine. Daughter, thy faith hath made thee whole. Go in peace. But Jairus is not smiling, because look at what happens in verse 35. While he, Jesus, yet spake, there came from the ruler of the synagogue's house certain which said, thy daughter is dead. Why troublest thou the master any further? Now, I don't know how this played out. I believe Jairus was probably out of the crowd because he's still trying to figure out what's going on. The crowd's back around Jesus. And he's watching Jesus talk to this stranger. And whether he looks back towards his house or whether the guy comes and taps him on the shoulder, but somebody from his house comes and says, and the tears are already flowing down his face. And Jairus knows. I think it's probably like in the military. I don't know. I've never experienced this. When someone's at home and they get a knock at the door and they open the door not expecting anything and they see somebody in their dress blues and they say, oh no. Jairus gets this news from this messenger from his house. And his world is instantly shattered. His 12-year-old little girl, my little daughter. The Bible tells us, either in this passage or one of the parallel passages, this was his only daughter, is dead. And they said, don't trouble the master anymore. Basically, there's nothing he can do. Death was a point of no return in their minds. They had faith that Jesus could heal her while she was living. But I've said this many times, God is not in a box. Now you say, well, how come he didn't heal me or my friend or my spouse or how come he didn't do that? Did he? My dad's not suffering anymore. He healed him. Just not the way we wanted him to. Jairus is crushed. Verse 36 says, and by the way, this was the key verse that I forgot to read at the beginning. As soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, we don't know how far Jesus was from Jairus. I feel like there was an amount of distance because of the crowd thronging him. And he's talking to the daughter who he just healed. And he hears the messenger, "Don't trouble the master. Your daughter's dead." And he comes to him and he says right here in verse 36, as soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he saith unto the ruler of the synagogue, "Be not afraid, only believe." Don't be afraid, just believe. And I believe he was smiling. When he looked at Jairus, maybe put his hand on his shoulder and said, "Don't be afraid. It's going to be okay. Just believe. Have faith. Have the faith that you came to me in a while ago. Have faith. Have the faith of this daughter." And maybe when he said it, maybe, is this working? Not working? So I got to stay here. Maybe when he said it, he looks at Jairus and he says, "Be not afraid." And maybe he looks back over at this daughter who is whole now, who is healed and who is smiling radiantly and says, "Only believe." Do you think he believed at that point? I do. You know why? Because they went back to his house. Guys, our faith, James, the book of James says, I think it's chapter 2, says, our faith without works is dead. Oh, so we got to work our way to heaven, Bryant? Absolutely not. That is not what that is talking about. If you ever hear teaching that says that is what it's talking about, you better check it because they're giving you a false gospel. It's not about working to get to heaven. It's about the fact that because we have faith, it works. Remember what he said in there? You show me your faith without your works, and I'll show you my faith by my works. Last week we talked about, I asked you, had you ever seen the wind? It was a trick question. Some of y'all were like, "Yeah, I think so." And I'm like, "No, you haven't. No, you haven't seen the wind." "Yeah, I have. I saw it this morning. I was sitting there at my kitchen table, finishing my studying and preparing, and the leaves on the trees were moving. I saw the wind." I didn't see the wind. I saw the effects of the wind. And that's what our faith should have, is works to show our faith. Jairus showed his faith when he went to Jesus, when he got off the boat, and then he showed his faith when Jesus said, "Don't be afraid. Just believe." And maybe he said, "Okay." And they went back to his house. Now, things get a little interesting here. Verse 37, and he suffered no man to follow him save Peter and James and John, the brother of James. Okay, that's not the interesting part. And he cometh to the house of the ruler of the synagogue and seeth the tumult and them that wept and wailed greatly. In Matthew, you don't have to turn there, but just listen to Matthew, this account of this story. Probably should just put this verse in my notes. Oh, I'm not following my notes. There we are. Maybe it is in there. Yeah, Matthew 9:23. It says in Matthew 9:23, and when Jesus came into the ruler's house and saw the minstrels and the people making a noise. So in Bible times, when someone passed, it was almost like, I apologize for not studying it enough, but I understand it to be almost kind of like a coroner, but totally not. Y'all are like, well, that makes no sense. Hang in there with me. Who has to come pronounce someone dead? The coroner. Okay. There's a professional group. This sounds weird. Sounds like a weird, dark music group that would go to people's houses, and the minstrels were like a flute, and they would begin to play the mourning, M-O-U-R-N-I-N-G, song. Why would they do that? To let everyone know that someone in this house just passed. And everyone knew. The music was playing when Jesus got there. It says it here in Matthew chapter 9. Back in Mark 5, we'll stick to this one as far as our text. He says, and he cometh, verse 38, and he cometh to the house of the ruler of the synagogue, and seeth the tumult, and them that wept and wailed greatly. And when he was come in, he saith unto them, please, for a moment, put yourself on the family side of this story. He says, what make you this ado and weep? What are y'all doing? Why are you making all this noise? The damsel is not dead, but sleepeth. And they all went, oh, she's just been holding her breath for the last 30 minutes. She's going to be a sniper when she grows up, and she's trained her heart rate to kind of stop almost. Wow. I wish we had known that. But maybe it's possible that, and like I say, I apologize for not stating out that part of this group that comes and plays, one of them checks the pulse and says, she's gone. They knew she was dead. From all physical evidence, anyway. And Jesus says, why make ye this ado and weep? The damsel is not dead, but sleepeth. And look at what they did. This is recorded, this exact, almost exact word is recorded in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And they laughed him to scorn. If you've ever been laughed to scorn, you know they're not laughing with you. They're laughing at you. And it's meant as a cutting laugh, as basically, how, you idiot. Excuse me for saying that from the pulpit. But that's what they're doing when they laugh somebody to scorn. Like, what? What on earth? Dude, she's dead. We know it. And Jesus didn't go, I mean, I know she is, but I was trying to trick them, and so maybe something. No. He said, the middle part of verse 40, but when he had put them all out, he taketh the father and the mother of the damsel and them that were with him, this three disciples, and enter in where the damsel was laying. He put them all out. You know, we want to see Jesus as this super compassionate, and just hear me out before you cut me off. Please don't let live stream cut off when I'm in the middle of the statement. As this super compassionate and just caring and always talking in a very soft voice. Remember when we spoke, if y'all were in Sunday school a while back, we got to the passage of scripture in Luke that talked about where he overturned the money changers' tables, that he didn't go up to them and go, really weird not having a microphone while I'm over there, but he said, that's not how it happened, was it? He was angry. And I acted angry, and I scared Miss Betty. She went, woo, like, fix a scooter chair back. You know, just, he was angry. And I believe, this is a Bryantism, if you want to call it that, when he put the people out of the room, he didn't say, they're laughing him to scorn. He didn't say, would y'all please leave? Could y'all give us a minute? Hey, maybe he clapped his hands and said, get out. And they went. Like y'all just did. That was really loud. It worked pretty good. But he told them to get out. And they left. And in verse 41, and he took the damsel by the hand and said unto her, Talitha kumi, which is being interpreted, damsel, I say unto thee, arise. He takes the dead girl's hand and says, girl, get up. The parents are no doubt weeping. The three disciples are going, their eyes are as big as saucers. They're like, what's going to happen? Man, I wish I had a cell phone because I'd be recording. And the Bible says, verse 42, and straightway the damsel arose and walked, for she was of the age of 12 years. And they were astonished with a great astonishment. And he charged them straightly that no man should know it, and commanded that something should be given her to eat. You know what dead people don't do? They don't eat. She's alive. Jesus saw fit to raise Jairus' daughter from the dead. The word in verse 42, I love this part too, and straightway the damsel arose. You know what straightway means? Immediately. There was no lag in time. There was no long pause, and then she coughs like very dramatic in some of the movies we might have seen about whatever. And as soon as he spoke the words, she got up. You know, my questions to you this morning, my question to you is, are you struggling in your faith? Are you going, Brian, I've got this thing facing me and I just don't have enough faith? Well, remember, Jesus said the faith the size of a, I can't even show you, of a mustard seed can do what? Move mountains. Guys, it's not how much faith do we have. It's what is the object of our faith. When our faith is in something other than the Lord Jesus Christ and our Heavenly Father, we can be let down. When our faith is in our own selves, we will be let down. But when our faith is in God, we will not be let down. Now, I mentioned earlier, you say, well, I prayed for so-and-so to be healed from cancer or this disease or from this sickness, and they weren't. That's not helping my faith, Bryant. You know, and I think it's Isaiah, the Bible tells us that our thoughts are not his thoughts. Our ways are not his ways. His ways are higher. We can't understand what his plan is in some situations. And you know what? It's okay. Trust him. Have faith. You know, make sure your faith is in him and focused on him. And maybe today you don't understand much of what I've said. Maybe you're going, man, that was a great story. That was pretty cool. The hand clapping in the microphone was a little much, but that was a pretty cool story. But I don't understand much of what you're talking about. This whole church thing, this whole God thing, this whole Christ thing. Maybe you've never placed your faith in Christ alone. And do you realize you're a sinner? Do you realize you need a Savior? If you answer yes to those two questions, then accept the free gift of salvation today. Jesus already paid for it. It's yours for the taking. Romans 10:9 says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Brian, it can't be that easy. It is that easy. He did all the work. All we have to do is believe. Christian, if you're struggling this morning in your faith, give it to God. He will not let you down. He may show you that there's another answer other than what you've been asking for or praying for, but He will not leave us nor forsake us. He will answer our prayers. I'm not preaching a health and wealth message here. If you just believe and come down to this altar, you can be healed and have all the money in your bank. That's not what I'm saying. Just have faith in God. He won't let us down. And if you don't know Christ as your Savior, today is the day of salvation, the Bible says. We're never promised tomorrow. We're not even promised this afternoon. And this afternoon is 2 minutes away. Musicians, if you'll come at this time, we'll have a word of prayer, and then I'll invite you to stand for the time of invitation. Lord, thank you for this time we could be together. Thank you for your word that we could see this beautiful story from Mark chapter 5 today that involves two different daughters. Lord, just thank you so much that this chapter shows us that you have authority over demons, disease, and even death. Help our faith to be strong in you. Help us to lean on you. Lord, give us the strength. Help us. Help mine unbelief, one man said in the Bible. Lord, I pray that whatever each person here is facing, that you would give them the strength to trust you. And then if there's someone here that does not know Christ as their Savior, that today they would not put it off any longer, but today they would place their faith in Christ and Christ alone. Lord, just pray that you'd have your will and your way in this time of invitation. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Stand with me if you would. Brother Charles, lead us in a song.
Page 378.
Attention this morning. Thank you for being here. I trust it was an encouragement and a challenge to you as it was to me. Like I said this morning as I started, I don't know what was going on in everybody's heart, but I just felt like Satan was working against this service, as he probably was in many services this morning and still will as the morning's continuing on across the world. But greater is he who's in me than he who's in the world. If you have any troubles or needs or something you want to share, just let me know. I'll pray for you. You don't have to give me details. We want to help each other. We want to pray for one another. We want to bear one another's burdens. Thank you for being here this morning. Brother Scott, would you dismiss us in a word of prayer, please, sir?